Gail put it very nicely when she said that Dad had no need for memorial services. He told Mother he did not want one. She said, well, we're having one. You can be there or not, that's up to you. See, Mother has a better sense of humor than some of you, give her credit. But the roles Dad has had, and a few of them Mickey and Roland discussed and Gail mentioned, but the roles that were most important to Dad were the ones that Gail talked about related to family. Being a son, being a brother, being a dad, being a husband, being an uncle, being a grandfather, and very importantly to him in the last several years is being a great uncle as well. Fortunately, our family does not need me to talk about that today. They already know how he is, which is a good thing because I am not emotionally prepared to talk about that at all. But what Dad also was, which was vital for me and also for many others, I think, was a great teacher. And he taught me so many different lessons. People think of him as a teacher because he was a minister. And that's true. And he said that to be an effective minister, one had to be part theologian, part counselor, and part psychologist, which he was all of those things. And he stopped being a minister before I was born officially in terms of having a specific church. But I've heard him speak many times at all sorts of functions and then as president still for a long time. But the most important lessons he taught me were actually with few words. Actions. Some of you know in my parents' house there are just a couple of books, and I was going through them recently when you're alternating and trying to be nitrous for Dad. And I came across one called Life 101 that I skimmed through a bunch of years ago, and it's got quotes and sayings and different things in it. And there was one in there that just struck me and made me think of Dad so much. And it's from someone I've never heard of, who apparently is a British author and humorist. But he said, this reminded me of Dad. My function in life was to render clear what was already blindingly conspicuous. Which, you know, isn't how Dad would speak, but Dad would have liked that quote. Because Dad would have gotten the irony in it. Because often, the hardest lessons in life to fully understand, meaning as Dad talked about it, to internalize it so that you've incorporated it into your own behavior, are the most obvious ones. And Dad helped me with obvious lessons time and time and time again. About 20 years ago, I was facing a significant life decision, a commitment that if I made it, I really needed to be all in on. And I called Dad and I laid out all the pros and cons and I took through all of these steps, and Dad was silent, as he usually was. But then he didn't say anything, and I said, Dad, well, what do you think? There was another pause, and he said, Colin, the fact that we're having this conversation is the answer to your question. And that was spot on. You know, if you were too uncertain about whether you can draw a line that is true to yourself or take a major step, that tells you a lot about your level of commitment or conviction. And Dad repeatedly taught that if you don't know what the line is that you are unwilling to cross in any situation, transaction, relationship, personal or business, you name it, then you have no real power. And this was not a bluff. This is not something at a poker table where you can bluff for a period of time. This is something where you have to really internalize it and understand. And Dad said one way to think about whether you could even draw that line in any certain situation or relationship was to ask yourself, what are you really prepared to do? And Dad and I watched a lot of movies together over the years. Dad always liked the movie The Untouchables, which is about Elliot Ness getting Al Capone. And his favorite character in it was not Elliot Ness, played by Kevin Costner, but it was this old Irish cop played by Sean Connery. His question, both repeatedly to Elliot Ness in a church scene and then at the end, his dying words was, what are you prepared to do? That was always Dad's question. usually said it to me very categorically, very quietly, but he knew that had the most effect on me. To Dad, in real life, this is not it's not a macho gauntlet throwing down to some to see how tough you are type of thing. This was an integral decision to decide what personal determinations matter to you. So to accurately know what you were willing to do, you have to analyze and determine what you were not prepared to do. So both sides of that coin are essential. And he always talked about that, determining that answer first and then incorporating it into your life in real terms. That, said Dad, is personal power. It was obvious to Dad in 1961 in the South, when he was here at Vanderbilt Divinity School in Nashville, that it was wrong that blacks were not allowed to eat the same place as whites. Okay, that may sound obvious to us, though it was not to a majority of whites in the South in the late 1950s and early 1960s. But putting the history of it aside, for those who did agree that the discrimination was wrong, what were you willing to actually do in the moment? Were you willing to be arrested? Are you willing to have your own mom and your future wife's family embarrassed by your actions? Dad was. Were you willing to walk up to armed men holding clubs, calling you the worst names they could think of, and you said they were going to beat you up or worse? Dad was. Knowing what the right thing is important. A lot of people talk about it, and Dad used to say also, you know, that's half the battle. But being willing to actually take action to effectuate that right which you have determined, and as Dad would hope have prayed on, and you have come to the conclusion is right, is what distinguished Dad from most of humanity. An obvious step in trying to reach the right outcome is you have to decide which action is correct to take, right? You have to decide what are you going to actually do, and that's a lot harder in real life than it's a lot easier to say than it is to do. And Dad always said, look, you don't have to figure out all the steps in advance. Almost no one can do that, because it's not like a chess game where you try and plot it out and know 10 or 12 steps ahead where you may move. He said, decide on one step that is in the right direction. You believe that path that step takes you down the path that's the right direction. If you are wrong about the path you start down, that's okay, he always said. As long as you take intentional, positive energy, he said the universe or God can redirect that action and can channel it. But if you don't, if you allow inertia to continue you on your current path that you know is not right, even if you're not sure which path to take to break the inappropriate or path that no longer works for you that you're currently on, then there is no positive energy for God or the universe to redirect. After Dad graduated from Vanderbilt Divinity School and married Mother, which is a lesson in and of itself that we should talk about, but we won't, how he pulled that off. The Vietnam War was approaching, and Dad was exempt from going because ministers did not have to serve or fight for the country. Dad thought that was so conspicuously wrong. He said he believed that violated the First Amendment and specifically the separation of church and state. And he said to me, in real terms, he said, guys from my high school were going to have to go fight. Why wasn't I going to have to go? How is that right? But what was he prepared to do? Well, he joined the army, not as a chaplain, but in the infantry. He said they made fun of him because he was, you know, minister, and they said, he shot expert, because the one thing he ever said with any pride about anything related to the Army or Vietnam that I ever heard from him. But he had to figure out some way to make at least some money, because he was married now. And so he joined, and he was, after completing basic training, went into officer candidate school. And he completed that. He said about officer candidate school something that he also said to me and other people about a number of major life experiences. He said people either grew or they quit, but sometimes they do both. In that case, he grew and he didn't quit, but he always acknowledged that people do, and wasn't concerned about whether they did or not, just whether you grew from it. After Macros, yes. Dad ended up at Fort Devens in Massachusetts. He was in a unit that was up there training to go into Cold Warfare, of all things. And he was a second lieutenant, but somewhat unusually, he was being utilized as the XO, the executive officer for the CO, for the commanding officer of the base. And normally that would have been a captain or major, apparently, but he didn't have that person for whatever reason, and Dad was sort of the acting XO. So Dad was training with his unit for all this cold weather stuff, serving as the XO, and mother and him were living up there. Dad's unit received orders to go to Vietnam. Now, Grand Andy, my mother's father, as many of you know, had been in Congress for some time then, and he was monitoring the situation and was prepared for it. And when it occurred, he had Dad's orders changed so that Dad would come to D.C. and serve out the war in the Honor Guard. And so back, and Dad did not know this yet, was talking with the CO about leaving and going to Vietnam. And the CO said, "Malcolm, I can't let you go. I don't have any other CO. You're my acting CO. You're staying. You're not going." And that wasn't what Dad wanted. He wanted to go with his men and with his unit. So when the orders came through, which all had to go through the XO to get to the CO, and the CO had no idea who Dad's father-in-law was, and Dad went in and talked to him and said, "Well, sir, you're going to lose me either way. Either I'm going to Vietnam or the Honor Guard, so you might as well send me with my unit." So he, the CO, had Dad's orders changed again, and he went with his unit and got over there. I would have liked to have seen Grandaddy's face when he heard that. But so after all that, I remember asking Dad, you know, you did all this maneuvering just to get to Vietnam. You know, how did you feel once you were actually there in Vietnam? And he laughed and laughed, and he said, "I thought, boy, am I an idiot." Dad was in Vietnam during 1965 and 66, and there were major battles back then. They had really large battles between the Viet Cong and infantry, and apparently we won a lot of those battles, and so they shifted tactics over the years. But early on, it was a lot of taking land, taking ground during the day, and then trying to protect it, barbed wires, mortars, everything, and then they went to the DC with attack during the night. And I asked Dad about Vietnam a lot, particularly when I was a boy and younger, and it was like pulling teeth to get it out from him, but I did over the years learn a few things, and he shared some lessons about it. The short paper version is, during his time there, he received a field promotion to first lieutenant. He was awarded a Bronze Star. He was, after another later major battle, blown up against a truck and had shrapnel on his back. When he was in the hospital and they were had taken the shrapnel out, they said, "We're going to offer you a Purple Heart," and he turned it down and was back in combat very soon thereafter. They didn't get all that shrapnel out, by the way. I used to track when I was a little boy, and a piece of shrapnel was still in his back, and it moved about an inch over the years. He had more than one close call in Vietnam that, by all reason, would have been the end of him, should have been. By any rational measure. Things like crawling out of a foxhole during a mortar attack, and he had either a mortar or a rifle grenade, I wasn't clear on which, land between him and another guy, and it was a dud, fortunately. But there's one time in particular that stands out to me, because I think it was the most searing and long-lasting for him. They were out in force one night, not just in platoon, but with several platoons, maybe close to a company, and he somehow got separated from all of his men. I think he was in the last unit, and maybe he was doing something at the end, but in any event, he got separated, and he could hear the Viet Cong chattering in front of him, and he said it sounded like there were hundreds of them. He realized there was no chance of getting back to the men without going through these guys, and that was it. And he laid down, he set out his grenade and his clips, and he said he settled a deep prayer, and then he said it was over, I knew I was done. And he said they walked so close to him, and he said, you know, they were these black pajama-like things. He said they were so close to me, they were chattering, because I thought they were going to step on me. And he said, to this day, I felt this power, and I felt that God put a protective shield over me and made me invisible to them. by saying he had seen things in his early days in Vietnam that the Viet Cong did to their own. And based on that, he had decided that he was not going to voluntarily go, or not voluntarily surrender. And what he taught me about that in life and easier circumstances is that you cannot give yourself over to those who will betray the very people who they are supposed to serve, who they've been appointed to or elected to or have volunteered to serve and to lead. He said to me, if someone shows you with his actions that he puts himself over the people he is supposed to be serving, do never continue to support that person or trust them. And specifically, Dad talked about this in an organizational sense. He talked about what he called inner integrity, whether in a group or a business or a church or a community or a country. And he said, that if a group has elected someone who is not living up to the same standards, he said, the choice is this, quote, the founder or leader is expected to live according to the same standards as the other members or not. That's the question. That's what inner integrity is. And Dad was faced with that quandary in the early years of the Stell Group because the founder was a man who, as I understand it, said, do as I say, but no one else was permitted to behave as he did. And Dad said that about that time in Stell, character growth and community growth without freedom was a contradiction in terms for us. And he said that a primary lesson people have had to face and will continue to face is, would the members of the community fight to establish a participatory democracy, or would they yield the community's freedom to a select few? And still, when the people were faced with that choice, they voted the founder out, elected the board, and elected that president. And he said, we just created a governing participatory democracy. It was always about we and us for that. About democracy itself, Dad said, democracy does not create, democracy allows. Democracy makes more difficult the abuse of power, but democracy does not convey power. Democracy makes more clear that real power, personal power, comes from within. That was something that Dad was always trying to get me to understand, is what is practical and what is powerful for you personally is also often what is best for other people. You've seen on the program the golden rule there, and Dad absolutely believed that. He believed it not just as something as a guideline to follow, he believed that that's the way the universe actually worked. And one of the ways in which he did is, he said that when, and this partially relates to childhood and relates to parents, but he said that if you're not able to learn to accept, he said, learn to accept your parents for their strengths and their weaknesses, then not to do so is for you to limit your own capacity for freedom and for growth. For all of our adult lives. To do so, in other words, to accept your parents fully, is to find self-acceptance and self-esteem. Dad said, it's okay to go through the adolescent rebellion, which is rebellion, youth, those phrases. But you need to understand, if you're going to be a mature adult, that resenting other people, and parents was the easiest example. No, he wasn't talking about it. I'm often the luckiest person there is in terms of parents, is when you're resenting others, you're doing something that weakens yourself, and it limits your own self-growth. It's not about them. For that, it was never about them. He never spoke badly about other people. He never repeated gossip about other people. He most of all never wanted to cause anyone else guilt. And that's a really incredible thing to think about going through life and not causing others to feel guilt. He never saw the point. There was no reason to do that. He always said, leave judgment to others. He said, that's what Christ said. Anyone who thinks that isn't a true Christian if they think we're here to judge. The people on the planet aren't that smart, is what he used to say. Dad really talked about letting go. It was something that he sent out to a lot of the family as well. And there's books on that, how to do it, it's readily available. But he talked to me about giving up things to God. And then for those who didn't want to think of it in a Christian sense, then also these methods for letting go. He says the most powerful instant way to get emotion, negative emotions, and to get rid of them, and to alleviate those feelings, grief, guilt, whatever it is. But there's the part that stuck with me is the part that he said about learning to accept our parents, because that's what he said letting go is, letting go of resentment of others, is how you grow. It's about your own growth, not about the other people. Dad, and one lesson that serves way more time than I'm giving it, but that's the power of belief and a visualization. And I can't tell you how many times in my life how Dad taught me to think in the moment and visualize and picture something happening after it is, as if it is already done, as if it's a fait accompli. He talked about that. That made all the difference in my life in so many ways. But the easiest example for me is the one that he left us with about the power of expectation and belief, which is if you believe something strongly enough or clearly enough or as if it's fact, then it will come to pass. Our dear grandma Liz, Dad's mom, died almost 2 decades ago now. Since that time, Dad said way too often, I didn't like hearing it, he said, yeah, I won't live longer than mom. He talked about that. I don't know where he got that from. It was somehow that wasn't going to occur. She died Christmas Day 2000. She was 82 and a half years old. Just a few months after that. Dad died 2 weeks ago today. And he was just a few weeks younger than her. So that was a parting shot from Dad to see belief matter works. The other fun thing was he wasn't eating the last couple of months. So we were trying to get him anything to eat, and Mom actually went and got him a milkshake from a fast food place for the first time in her life, and he was like, small victories. Small victories. Oh. I appreciate him saying that. Dad had one, I'll call it a commandment, he would never do that to us, but one test that he said that you and your sister, this is the test of whether or not you have done your job. He said, the test is this. He said, the test is the key to the improvement of all of society. For all who are or become parents, it is your job to be a better father or mother to your child than your mother or father was to you. Dad said, this is how humanity trends upwards over time. With respect to being a better father than their dad was to them, my dad, Uncle Charlie and Uncle Brighton, they've easily passed that test. It seems unfathomable to me to be a better dad than a better father than dad was to me. But as Dad says, when you know what you need to do, just not yet how to do it, then begin with a step